than 75 miles, roaring northeastward through Conway Springs and Hayesville, one small town after another. It brushed Wichita and hit Andover, Kansas, head-on. It pretty much destroyed the town. Kansas is used to tornadoes, and a lot of people in Andover didn't take cover. My neighbors didn't go to the shelter, a woman said. They've always rode them out. The storm killed 19 people in Andover alone. It is still April. There were tornadoes yesterday, and there may be more today and tomorrow. If you hear one is coming, even if you're used to tornadoes, take cover. It may be the one you can't ride out.
Shadow of a Doubt is personal favorite. Good old Uncle Charlie comes back to a small town to spend some time with his sister and her children. And good old Uncle Charlie turns out to be a serial killer. So much for American innocence. It was as if Uncle Charlie were the shadow of a diseased Europe, the dark side of our optimism and naivete. This is the movie they've remade for television tonight on CBS.
Instead of Joseph Cotton, Mark Harmon plays Uncle Charlie. Pretty boy Harmon is getting better. He used to want to be George Hamilton.
How could you let them go into my room, Charlie?
I'm sorry.
Give me the film, please.
Lately, he's tried to be Montgomery Clift and Henry Fonda.
Give it to me!
He's serviceable as the psycho who kills rich widows.
You're very naughty, you know.
Uncle Charlie, I'm sorry to bother you, but I left my slippers under the bed.
Margaret Welsh, as his niece, for whom guilty secrets are all mixed up with teenage sex, is as good as Teresa Wright was.
I know something. I know a secret that you don't think I know.
Charles, you can't leave. What about my ladies' club Wednesday night that you're going to talk to?
And Diane Ladd, as Charlie's muddled sister Emma, is terrific. With a nod to another Hitchcock movie, Tippi Hedren is strangled. Shirley Knight, maybe next. Why does Charlie do it? He explains, sort of.
Useless women. You see them in hotels and resorts, fancy restaurants, spending the money, eating the money, drinking the money, smelling of money. Proud of nothing except for their jewelry and their houses, these useless, fat, faded, greedy women.
They're human beings. They're alive.
Are they, Charlie?
Shadow's not bad, though not even Karen Arthur is going to improve on Hitchcock, who disturbed us by tickling the unconscious dread instead of thumping on it. Movies like Shadow get remade because remakes are easier than dreaming up something new. I'm more interested in the culture's continuing obsession with serial killers. Ted Bundy, Charlie Manson, the Hillside Strangler, Son of Sam. And how we imagine why they do what they do. And the ways we've had to up the ante on the horror in order to feel anything at all while we watch them do it. Consider Jonathan Demme's terrifying Silence of the Lambs.
Thank you, Barney.
Jodie Foster, a wonderful feminist heroine, must consult one psycho to catch another.
What did you mean by fledgling killer? Are you saying that he's killed again?
I'm offering you a psychological profile of Buffalo Bill based on the case evidence.
The first psycho, Anthony Hopkins, eats people.
The doctors managed to reset her jaw, more or less, save one of her eyes. His pulse never got above 85. Even when he ate her tongue.
The second psycho has sexual identity problems. He abducts young women, then fattens them up before he skins them. Well, even Hitchcock, 18 years after Shadow of a Doubt, had to get more obvious and bloody in Psycho. And Tony Perkins had sexual identity problems too. Blame his mother. But what's bugging Patrick, the 27-year-old Wall Street broker in the controversial and ludicrous new novel, American Psycho. He wears Ralph Lauren silk pajamas, eats quail sashimi, and snorts coke when he isn't visiting a masseuse or a tanning salon. Why does he also torture dogs, pop the eyes out of homeless beggars, and rape and dismember yuppie women? I'll explain. When Patrick tells people that he's into murders and executions, what they hear him say is mergers and acquisitions. When he makes obscene phone calls to schoolgirls, he whispers, "I'm a corporate raider. I orchestrate hostile takeovers." In other words, what Bret Easton Ellis is really criticizing is late capitalism and the fetishizing of commodities. Do you believe that? Of course not. What these psychos are always about is the hatred of women. What's scary about the culture is that we seem to require this violence against women to be more and more explicit, a skinning and a dismemberment. Because it's so hard to shock us anymore, how are we supposed to feel anything at all when we look on the nightly news at television images of the luckless Kurds, the Palestinian dispossessed, the homeless on our own mean city streets? They just aren't thrilling enough.
And work songs. Cowboys, mule skinners, cotton pickers, Gandhi dancers, all sorts of working men and women sang songs once upon a time while they worked. We've lost most of that American music. Well, here is some we haven't lost. For countless generations, the Menhaden fishermen have been setting out to sea from Beaufort, North Carolina. The fish swim in schools of millions. They've been netted since Indian times for fish oil and fertilizer. Menhaden fishing never has been easy work and still isn't, even on Captain Bobby Martin's boat rigged with winches and pumps.
They don't exactly jump on this boat. We had to get down and work, get them on here, you know, but it's nowhere near like it used to be.
It used to be harder. That is something Captain Martin does not have to tell the three honored guests he has with him this trip. They know how it used to be. Henry Pritchard knows. 50 years ago, the Menhaden boat on which he was working went down in Beaufort Harbor. 17 of his shipmates drowned that day or froze to death before anyone could get to them. John Henry Pritchard knows how it used to be.
On the back, down on that bridge, ice had froze up a solid post of ice. About four of them back there through them holes.
John Jones does too. And so does John Bell. He remembers.
And it got so rough, we had to let the fish go. And we try to take our boats up.
This is how it used to be. They didn't have any hydraulic winches to pull their nets. They had strong arms. The nets weighed thousands of pounds. If the men did not pull together, steadily, powerfully, fold by gathered fold of the net, all exactly at once, the catch might be lost. They might be lost overboard with the enormous slipping weight of what they held in their hands. To get themselves pulling together, to lift the nets, to lift their spirits, they sang.
Roseanne, Roseanne, you are so sweet. Bye-bye, bye-bye. Oh, Nana. Bye-bye, bye-bye. My darling child, I won't be home tomorrow.
Mike Luster of the North Carolina Maritime Museum had heard about the hauling shanties the old Menhaden men sang.
And I said, is there anyone around who remembers these songs? Who sang lead with these songs? He said, John Jones, and he lives right over here.
Mike Luster discovered that other retired Menhaden men were still to be found on shore. Before long, 13 of them were getting together most every Friday night, trading stories of how it used to be. and singing the shanties that got them through the hard, cold work at sea.
So cold, your hand was swell and bust, and you still had to pull. You had to carry your load. So you start singing them shanty songs, that give you spirit to go on. And that the way it was.
You had to learn how to pull. Now, as you pull one hand, you catch the other hand to pull. You pull again, you throw it this way. Next time, you throw it that way. You keep it level, so you have a level place, so you can have your balance. Keep your balance. As you pull in there, then you throw it so it'll be level. Keep pulling, keep pulling, keep pulling, keep pulling. This is the kind of straining work where you give it your all that you got. You're gonna take all you got to get them up, and everybody knows that. And then somebody want to put some joy into it, or either some sorrow into it. See, the shanty song either bring joy or either sorrow.
And I'm going home.
So when they sang that shanty, oh, me. Oh, something else happened to you. Start singing something like, I left my baby standing in the back door crying. Come on, boy, let's get these fish.
I left my baby.
If you ask John Jones or John Bell why they're doing what they're doing, they're saying to keep these songs alive, to hand it on to the next generation. We almost lost these songs, and they want to hand it on. And it's not just Menhaden fishermen's heritage. It's the heritage of the Gandhi dancers. It's the heritage of the mule skinners. It's the heritage of the agricultural workers. It's the American heritage.
Not long ago, the shanty singers of Beaufort, North Carolina, did something they never dreamed they'd do. They went north to Carnegie Hall in New York City to show people how it used to be, to bring the nearly forgotten songs of the Menhaden men back to life again. Have mattered really if these songs had been lost? Well, slender cords are made strong when they're twisted together into rope or knotted into net. Aren't men made strong just that way, by being bound together? And isn't history a net of memories knotted together? There would have been a big hole in the net of memory if these strands had been lost.
Oh,
kept sending them at us.
What they say tells a story no one else can.
It's you against him.
View World War II from a unique perspective. The Soldiers. GI Diary. Tuesdays at 8 Eastern, only on the Discovery Channel.
For 70 years, they've given form and...
Environmentalists are rallying together to try to save the desert tortoise, a threatened species scientists say hasn't a chance unless man intervenes. Environmentalists believe the California Desert Protection Act, now before Congress, may be the answer. The law would designate 11 million acres as national parks and wilderness areas. It would limit the use of off-road vehicles, which smash tortoises in their burrows. It would also control grazing cattle, which compete with the tortoise for food.
A cow in 2 days eats twice as much as what a tortoise eats in an entire year.
The law would also control gold mining, which digs up the desert floor where the tortoise burrows. Environmentalists believe the survival of the tortoise is essential, and that its plight is a sign that the desert itself is in serious trouble. I'm Sue Palka for Discovery Now.
So in my interview, they told me how Dow...
Fast jets are the most exciting aircraft in the sky. And this is the most exciting of all the fast jets. Popularly called the Blackbird, the Lockheed SR-71 was at one time a top secret reconnaissance aircraft which flew so fast and so high that nobody could shoot it down. First flown in December 1964, it served the US Air Force until the end of 1989. With a shape like nothing else in the sky, it could cover a mile in just over a second and a half. Flying at heights of up to 16 miles above the ground, a single SR could photograph 80,000 square miles of territory in an hour, probably without anyone on the ground knowing it was being done. The two huge Pratt & Whitney engines gulped fuel rapidly. So on many missions, the Blackbird had to slow down, come downstairs, and formate carefully behind a tanker. In this case, a KC-10. It had to be a special tanker, carrying special fuel, called JP-7. The boom operator aboard the tanker had the sole responsibility of driving his pivoted boom into the SR-71's receptacle. How much fuel? We'd like 12,000 gallons, please, and you might wipe our heat-resistant, bird-proof windshields. The landing might be half a world away, probably in California, or Okinawa, or, as in this case, Mildenhall in England. Aircraft enthusiasts everywhere will miss the jagged black monsters. Another world beater that has been around a long time is the General Dynamics F-111, popularly called the Aardvark because of its long nose. The F-111 first flew just one day ahead of the SR-71 on December 21, 1964. It was planned as a fighter, but entered USAF service as the world's best all-weather tactical bomber. Even today, this F-111F, taxiing out from its bomb-proof shelter at Lakenheath, England, can fly precision attack missions over ranges in all weather that few other aircraft could accomplish. The 111 was the first aircraft in service with pivoted swing wings. These are spread out to a wide span for a heavily laden takeoff. Long flames from the TF-30 engines thrust it down the runway, and when throttled back, provide economical propulsion for anything up to 2,900 miles. In this aircraft, pilot and navigator sit side by side. The right-seater manages a mass of electronic displays and navigation, weapon, and electronic warfare controls, leaving the pilot to drive the 50 tons of supersonic metal. This F version has a paved Todd recessed into its belly to provide infrared pictures of the ground and accurate laser ranging to the target. The paved tact screen looks the same day or night, or even in fog, so the bomb can always be put on the target. Then the paved tack pod is retracted back inside. Its laser can illuminate targets for the paveway missiles carried under the wings. These are really laser-guided bombs with pinpoint accuracy. The USAF has about 380 111s. And they are being progressively upgraded with new equipment to keep them on the top line. One of the smallest of the fast jets is the Jaguar, a neat little bird with stocky legs to give plenty of ground clearance even with huge tanks or bombs underneath. Britain and France collaborated to build 573 for various customers. These three are seen on takeoff from Lancashire on the delivery flight to Oman in the Persian Gulf. Each has two tiny afterburning turbofan engines, which give really economical and reliable power over the most arduous missions. As for those long legs, the landing gears have to be not only long, but also strong and well sprung, withstand takeoffs from rough strips. In any war, an aircraft parked on an airfield will vanish on day one. So it helps to be able to take off from any bit of open country. The Jaguar's primary missions are low-level tactical attack and reconnaissance, but customers can have overwing pylons for air-to-air missiles, such as this red-painted Magic. RAF Jaguars have done well in red flag exercises in the USA, proving to be very tough and elusive. One American fighter pilot trying to intercept Jaguars said, "These boys really shave the rocks. Their tactics are good, very good." In the chisel-like nose is a laser for giving precise target range, which is vital in putting ordinary iron bombs accurately on the target, and the tiny Jaguar can carry nearly 5 tons of bombs. And how about this? The first Jaguar to land on a stretch of British highway and then take off again. Jaguar pilots train in Welsh or Scottish valleys, keeping low. The HUD, the head-up display, provides the guidance the pilot needs as he threads his way over the ground at nearly the speed of sound. We'll return the attack mission. The McDonnell Douglas FA-18 Hornet has been sold to many countries, despite the fact that it was designed to fly from aircraft carriers. Steam catapults brutally fling the Hornet off the bows, perhaps 6 times a day. A beautiful aircraft to fly, the Hornet was developed from a Northrop lightweight fighter intended for use from airfields. It pioneered modern cockpits, in which traditional dial instruments are almost completely replaced by three giant color electronic displays. Above the nose is a 20-millimeter gun, and external racks are provided for various weapons, including large radar-guided air-to-air missiles. The aircraft's radar is so good that although designed more than 10 years ago, it is being forcibly proposed by Germany for the European fighter aircraft for the next century. On top of all that, the Hornet is as agile as they come. In contrast, the Grumman F-14A Tomcat is a heavyweight, the backbone of the air defense of the U.S. Navy's giant carriers since 1974. From the start, it has been a belt and braces aircraft with two engines, two crew, swing wings, a gun, and no fewer than three classes of air-to-air missile. Powered by two TF-30 engines related to those of the F-111, the Tomcat suffered various problems. But today's F-14A Plus and F-14D with General Electric engines not only has greater reliability and safety, but considerably enhanced performance. F-14 pilots periodically go to Miramar or similar U.S. Navy stations where top gun instructors hone their skills to razor sharpness. The big F-14s are pitted against F-5, TA-4, Kefir, or F-16N opponents, which use every trick in the book to make life hard for the pupil crew, no matter what their rank or experience. Out of the range at China Lake or Point Magoo, the Tomcat can fire its huge Phoenix missiles. The West's only AAM able to intercept hostile targets from a range of over 100 miles. Each AIM-54 Phoenix costs over $1 million, but is worth it if it means a kill every time, and from such a distance. Back at the home carrier, the Tomcat slams onto the deck and hopes to pick up the third of the ship's arrestors to be brought to a shuddering halt. Even seen in slow motion, the typical carrier landing is visible torture to the aircraft. No wonder Grumman is known as the Ironworks, because their aircraft never break. Newest French fighter is the Dassault Rafale, a name which means squall or hurricane. Powered by two new M88 afterburning turbofans, the Rafale is packed with the latest fighter technology and has the fashionable configuration of a giant delta wing and canard foreplanes. It is being developed in two forms, the Rafale D and Rafale M. The D will be a two-seat, multi-role, land-based fighter, 250 of which are needed by the French Air Force. The M will be a single-seat, carrier-based fighter, 86 of which are wanted by the French Navy. Like all modern dark fighters, the Rafale can have engine thrust greater than the clean gross weight, and it carries various missiles as well as a gun. By March 1989, the prototype had made 92 practice approaches to French aircraft carriers. Though, of course, with no arrestor hook, it could not land. But the French Navy may need to buy Hornets to tide them over until Rafales are available in late 1998. Thank you. This is the EAP, a British prototype which is assisting the development of the European fighter aircraft. First flown in August 1986, the EAP is powered by two RB-199 engines, and here has all the features of a modern fighter designed for close combat, apart from armament. Its huge wing, with an area of 560 square feet, combines with canards and brute engine thrust to give unsurpassed maneuverability, and also extremely short takeoff. The program for the eventual EFA has been clouded by shoestring funding, delays and disagreements between the partners, which are Britain, West Germany, Italy and Spain. There is even a suggestion that the thaw in the Cold War may result in the project's cancellation. But EAP remains a vital research and training tool for use should EFA actually go ahead. We'll return to fast jets. F-16. You program the displays, open the throttle to the mighty engine, and simply leap into the sky. Once airborne, you have the most agile thing in creation. Lying back in a reclining seat under a canopy like a giant goldfish bowl, you can see everywhere. And if you really feel up to it, you can slam into a sustained 9G turn, something no Western fighter could do previously. The one shortcoming of the F-16 was the lack of a long-range missile, but that is rectified by the new AMRAAM now coming into service. The F-16 pilot merely sets up his HUD for the air-to-air mode and puts the pipper, the aiming mark, on the target. Then he virtually cannot miss. Head-on, the F-16 has a mean shot-like look, and it's curtains for any of the bad guys who get such a view, because they'll never escape. The F-16 is also one of the world's best ground attack aircraft. Early versions could only fly this mission if the pilot could see the target. But since 1986, extra equipment called Lantern has allowed precision attacks to be made at night or in bad weather. The avionics warn the pilot not to make a turn towards high ground. They tell him to pull up when he gets too low. The pilot can even see an infrared image of targets as small as a tank. One advantage the F-16 had over a rival was that its engine was the same as that of the F-15 Eagle, the difference being that the mighty F-15 has two. With 48,000 pounds of thrust, even the weighty Eagle fairly leaps into the sky. And if it is lightly loaded, it can climb straight up and stay that way until it is out of sight. But the F-15 was not designed just to thrill airshow crowds. It was originally designed in 1970 to beat the Soviet MiG-25 Foxbat, and since then, it has been undisputed king of the U.S. Air Force. Despite being a large aircraft, the F-15 is agile, and the nimble F-5 Tigers of the aggressor training schools find them very hard to beat, which is as it should be. Here, an F-15 fires one of the new AMRAAM fire-and-forget missiles, which are now being issued to F-15 squadrons around the world. Today, McDonnell Douglas is flying the SMTD, meaning Stall and Maneuvering Technology Demonstrator, an F-15 with vectored engine nozzles and canard foreplanes, giving it shorter field length and even greater in-flight agility. The F-15E two-seat all-weather attack fighter is another new version. The RAF's counterpart is the Tornado F-3, but this is a very different animal. The interceptor version of the Tornado multi-role attack aircraft. Instead of having huge and thirsty engines, the F-3 has quite small power plants, giving it the economy to fly from Britain to somewhere like Iceland if necessary, even in a blizzard or at night, to investigate unidentified air prowlers. Again, like the F-14 and the F-4, the crew sit one behind the other. The backseater manages three multifunction electronic displays, though the pilot also has a display on which he can see various pictures, the most notable created by the radar. The main armament comprises four big radar-guided missiles, either Sparrows or Sky Flashers, recessed under the Tornado's broad belly. With wings folded back, the Tornado can make a dash at Mach 2.2, but with them spread out to the maximum wingspan, the heavy aircraft can fly slowly and operate from very short airstrips. This is the attack version of Tornado. It is shorter and looks chunkier. Each of the various customers has adopted particular weapon fits for their own particular missions. The West German Luftwaffe used the incredible MW1 dispenser, which can pump out up to 4,704 deadly bomblets in a single pass. Five kinds of bomblet can be loaded for quite different purposes. In contrast, the West German Marine Flieger, the naval air arm, used the heavy Cormoran-guided missile against ships. The RAF fly Tornadoes along training routes down the valleys even faster than Harriers or Jaguars. They hug the ground to practice keeping under hostile radars, and in war, the crews would have to be able to do this even at night or in bad weather. Thanks to its swing wings, which can be tucked in beside the body, Tornado gives its crews a much smoother ride at low level than any aircraft with fixed wings. Occasionally, Tornado crews fly up to Luce Bay in southern Scotland to practice aiming live iron bombs against a target on a tiny island. Usually, the bombs are 1,000-pounders, and almost always, the crew gets a direct hit. Today's fast jets are bad news for the opposition.
Play Beethoven.
It was, as General Norman Schwarzkopf put it,
the mother of all homecomings.
Tampa, Florida is home base for General Schwarzkopf, and the city's welcome home at Tampa Stadium was a tribute to him and the Desert Storm troops that gave him his victory. The show, produced by the Walt Disney Company, had more red, white, and blue than a 4th of July parade. General Schwarzkopf, in his down-to-earth style, put his troops in the spotlight.
And what can I say about these valiant Marines out here? They stormed the Iraqi barriers. And they did what Marines do best. They kicked butt. They took names.
And it was one of his troops, an Air Force Reserve medical technician, Sergeant Lorraine Prevo, who brought even Storman Norman Schwarzkopf to tears.
We are saying thank you.
Here at Tampa Stadium, as at many troop homecomings, the theme song was God Bless the USA, a 1983 hit by Lee Greenwood that became a super hit thanks to Desert Storm. And the general, who seems never to be at a loss for words, was happy to sing along. Jill Doherty for CNN, Tampa.
Rain continues to fall
food in the gravel.
Fish like those live in comparatively shallow waters, 100 feet, 30 meters, something like that. Their world is a heavily inhabited one, and also quite a bright one, because the water is shallow enough to receive light from the sun. It's also one that's comparatively familiar to us. For one thing, all the sea fish
powers center down the waves. Underway on nuclear power, the Nautilus immediately set several speed and submerged endurance records. Her first core of uranium would propel her for more than 62,000 miles over the next 2 years, most of it spent underwater. A conventional submarine would have required more than 2 million gallons of diesel fuel. Her most notable achievement is the navigation of the North Pole on August 3, 1958. Submerged below the polar ice cap for 96 hours and nearly 2,000 miles, the Nautilus crossed from the Pacific Ocean to the Atlantic, gathering more scientific data on the Arctic Sea than ever found before. The strategic importance of nuclear power was becoming more self-evident with each accomplishment. The Skate and sister ship Sea Dragon would rendezvous at the North Pole, experimenting with multi-ship operations beneath ice. Arctic operations would become central to the forthcoming strategy of nuclear deterrence.
Nuclear submarines, the silent war.
Tube one fired electrically.
In its primary role, the attack submarine is a symphony of dedicated, highly trained men in concert, creating the most deadly force in the sea. The attack sub's primary weapon is the Mark 48 torpedo. Wire-guided with both active and passive sonars, its accuracy is deadly within its 20-mile range. A new technology weapon gives the attack submarine another dimension of power. Submarine-launched cruise missiles, SLCMs, would project the sub's range of attack far beyond its torpedo range. By flying above the ocean with coordinates supplied by a third party, the payload is delivered expediently and with no wake. The sub-rock missile, an anti-submarine weapon, travels at supersonic speeds to release a depth charge, either conventional or nuclear. Launched from a standard 21-inch torpedo tube, the solid rocket motors propel the warhead up to 35 miles to be guided through its descent by an inertial guidance system.
We'll build and place on station a fleet that will never attack first.
but possess sufficient powers of retaliation concealed beneath the sea to discourage any aggressor from launching an attack upon our security.
In response to the Soviets launching Sputnik in 1957, the United States scrambled to develop the ultimate in nuclear deterrence, the nuclear-powered ballistic missile submarine. Under Admiral William Raeborn, the Navy produced in record time a solid-fuel rocket which could be fired from a submerged position. The result was the George Washington class, utilizing the Polaris A-1 missile. By the end of 1961, five submarines of the George Washington class patrolled the North Atlantic and Mediterranean, each carrying 16 of the 1,200 nautical mile missiles. An improvement on the A-1, the Polaris A-2 slightly extended the missile's range to 1,500 nautical miles. Five ships of the Ethan Allen class were commissioned by 1963 with Polaris A-2 missile. Totally redesigned, the Polaris A-3 missile became operational in 1964. Improved solid fuel, a lighter casing, and an efficient use of space extended the range to 2,500 nautical miles. This impressive increase in range over the A-1 and A-2 missiles gave the ballistic submarine a far larger patrolling area, minimizing its vulnerability as a deterrent. The Lafayette became the mainstay of America's nuclear deterrent. Its Polaris A-3 missiles introduced maneuverable reentry vehicles, MRVs, effectively multiplying the missile's firepower. Packing 16 Polaris A-3 missiles, each with three 200-kiloton MRV warheads, each of the 31 Lafayette-class subs carries nearly 10 million tons of deterrent force. Unlike the attack sub's mission to seek and destroy, the ballistic sub's mission is to evade detection and avoid contact of any kind. It is a silent deterrent. The Poseidon missile surpassed the Polaris A-3's range to 2,800 nautical miles and could throw up to 10 MRVs of 50 kilotons each. In the light of continued Soviet missile buildup, Congress approved the development of the Ohio class of ballistic missile submarine in 1974. It is the largest sub in the American Navy, displacing an awesome 18,750 tons and measuring 560 feet long. But its gigantic size belies its mobility, quietness, and speed. The Ohio class is the nation's most survivable weapons system. This giant submarine spawned several innovations that revolutionized how submarines are built. Rather than create the massive hull first and then build the interior, a new modular approach was taken. The hull was built in sections on a grid system of rail tracks and transfer cars. As the interior of each hull section was filled out, it would then be welded to its neighboring section. This technique made installing major components easier and reduced total construction time.
Nuclear submarines, the silent warriors, will continue on Discovery Sunday.
I can't believe this report is due this afternoon.
What is that?
Kraft Free Italian.
You carry Italian dressing in your purse.
Hey, I love Italian.
Obviously.
You want some?
No, thank you. No, it's too much fat.
Oh, no, this is Kraft Free. See, fat free, cholesterol free.
It sounds great.
Just try it.
Mmm.
Kraft Free Italian non-fat dressing.
The ship is easier to maintain than earlier ballistic submarines. Officers and enlisted men alike enjoy excellent food, exercise, medical care, comfortable bunks, quiet study, and even privacy. It must be remembered that the men who serve in the silent service sacrifice a great deal to ensure our country's security. The Ohio class is the most sophisticated machine ever built. Each man on board has a specific task to perform in unison with the rest of the crew. In order to perform, he must be well trained. Training has always been a high priority for the submarine force, not only in matters of operations, but also in matters of survival. The submarine is inherently a dangerous machine, and should a mishap occur below the surface, the crew must be prepared to escape. This technique for escaping from depths down to 300 feet, known as blow and go, involves constantly releasing air from the lungs on the ascent. The get-wet chamber prepares submariners for the flooding emergencies, where teamwork is critical.
I'll stop.
At every level of command, there is more training to undergo. There could never be enough training to prepare for what can go wrong below the surface.
Aye, belay your heading.
Belay the headings, aye.
Sound a collision alarm. Emergency blow all main ballast. All ahead, sir.
An enemy submarine can be the most fearsome threat for surface fleet forces. As it is for submarines, sonar is the heartbeat of ASW. The hunt begins with a contact on the sound surveillance system, an array of hydrophones on the ocean floor.
Contact Keppel Vic to ASW OpCon and get a P3 out here and let's nail this thing down.
A land-based P3 Orion, equipped with a magnetic anomaly detection system, MAD, checks for slight disturbance in the Earth's magnetic field.
Sensor 1, the initial channel will be channel 8, followed by 7. Sensor 1 and 2, keep me updated. Any contact on any of these dive bars, 8, 9, 1, or 2. Final buoy is out at this time. Flight, here is your flight 2 point.
Tackle sensor 3. I have no radar and ESM contact on the scope at this time.
Gilbert, I might have a possible down the BFY on buoy number 4.
Yeah, TACO sensor 1. I believe I've got contact on dive bar 9 at this time.
Moderate strength ocean front located here. The most likely course of action for the contact would be to move north into the area of the ocean front.
It is integral in ASW to monitor environmental conditions in which the contact may seek cover.
And lay a pattern, listen for possible submarine approach from the northeast.
Hi, Admiral.
Carrier-based S-3 Viking jets will continue beyond the range of the P-3 Orions. Destroyers maneuver to the estimated location of the threat, its helicopters equipped with lamps dipping sonars.
We are closing at max sonar speed to get within passive detection range.
How soon can we expect to gain passive detection?
ASW officers aboard the destroyer estimate the present location of the threat based on the last sounding.
Sharps indicates 30 minutes after that, Captain.
Very well.
Supervisor, believe I hold submarine contact.
How's your echo quality?
Sharp and strong.
Go ahead and put it out.
All right.
PC, observe B-scan.
All stations sonar. Sonar has active B-scan contact off the starboard bow. Classification, possible sub-low.
With the threat located, they proceed to track the target. Had this not been peacetime, an anti-submarine weapon would have been deployed immediately.
Sonar supervisor, target tracker sees a shift in Doppler.
Sonar 2-5, CIC sonar, we now see the target with a down Doppler indicating the target is opening.
Hotel 2, Charlie 4, my searcher contact correlates your listener, over.
Hotel 2, Victor, Kong, maintaining, out.
Sonar soup, I have no echoes.
Okay, give B-scan back control.
Shifting control to B-scan.
TDC B-scan, I have control. You still see it?
I sure do.
Inform combat.
Aye. All stations sonar. Sonar has lost contact.
Hotel 2, Charlie 4. Lamps has contact. Buoy number 15 is hot. Over.
Buoy 15 is reported hot on the bearing 068.
B-scan contact off the starboard bow.
Because it is so hard to maintain the contact, the problem of effective ASW is one of numbers. So many resources must be dedicated to tracking one sub that to guard an entire coastline is nearly impossible. As opposing subs become more quiet, the problem grows in complexity. Fast, quiet, and evasive, the nuclear submarine is the ultimate weapon. Until a radical breakthrough in ASW technology occurs, the attack submarine will continue to rule the oceans, and the ballistic submarine will remain the most survivable deterrent.
Invention, Tuesdays at 9:30 Eastern on the Discovery Channel.
On the next Discovery Sunday, the mysteries inhabiting a dark corner of the human psyche. Do the dead walk invisibly among us? Can the human mind reach out to others? Are alien beings visiting planet Earth? Is anybody there? At 9 Eastern, then at 10:30.
The enemy is now in sight above the Palisades. Five great machines.
America in a panic over an invasion from Mars. Next week, beginning at 9 Eastern on Discovery Sunday. They have changed little since the time of the dinosaurs, yet they remain masters of their environment today. And you'll find them on the remote island of the Komodo dragon, hidden in the desert den of the rattlesnake, or even in your own backyard. Uncover their secrets and learn their surprising stories. Watch Cold-Blooded Creatures, premiering Sunday, May 12th, only on the Discovery Channel.
It can be downright frustrating and difficult to get perfect.
Georgette and I first met in Houston through a mutual friend. And, you know, normally when you haven't seen someone before, you're very wary. But when I first saw her come out of the elevator, I had gone to pick her up. I knew that I had done the right thing. It was a blind date, arranged for a mutual friend.
Oh, I thought this is too good to be true. I mean, a blind date can't be this handsome and that adorable. I figured this was really a godsend, and it proved to be a godsend.
I looked at this man. He was movie star handsome. I fell in love with him the moment I saw him.
And what attracted you the most in her? Her beauty?
Well, I should say her personality or her intelligence. But in truth, it was her good looks at first. We were married 2.5 years after we met.
He was tough, difficult. He really didn't want to get married again, I don't think. And he was not easy to talk into it. I mean, 2.5 years, it came close.
Where they live and work, in Washington, Houston, or New York, Robert and Georgette Mosbacher are a high-profile couple. They make time for each other, however, despite their demanding schedules.
Good afternoon, my parade.
Georgette Mosbacher, along with her sister, Lynn Gastevich, heads a cosmetics company called La Prairie. Robert Mosbacher, a Texas oil millionaire, was appointed to the cabinet in 1988 to serve as Secretary of Commerce. He's also a member of the circle of friends and advisors to President Bush. Mosbacher has played a pivotal role in attempting to bolster United States-Japanese trade relations, as well as being an outspoken advocate of the development of high-definition television by the U.S.
I had a very nice childhood, very good childhood. And I had a very loving parents, both of them. And I was the youngest. So, as people have reminded me, I was spoiled, and I loved it. My father became a millionaire by the time he was 21. And he did it by being quick and innovative, smart, and very hardworking. He was 12 years old, and he went down to a place called the Curb Exchange, which was the precursor to the American Stock Exchange. And he went through that, and he worked his way up, and he was truly self-made. He would say, because he sold his stocks before 1929 crash, that he was very lucky. But his friends have told me that he was very smart, and I think he was a combination of both. My father instilled the principle in me of hard work, always treating people fairly, and being, as he put it, picking up more than my share of the check. Many, many years ago, my father had a driver, but he never wanted us to be spoiled by the fact that we were well off. And he said to me one day, "Son, you look at those young boys over there playing stickball." And there were some black boys and some white boys. And he said, "You, the only difference between you and them is that you're lucky enough to have a father who was lucky enough to make some money."
Georgette Mosbacher's story may sound like a Cinderella tale, but she did not wait for a magic wand to change her life. She was born into a modest Midwestern family in Highland, Indiana, and lived on a street called Prairie Avenue. She worked as a young girl to help her mother raise her younger brother and two sisters.
My father was killed in an automobile accident when I was 7, and I'm the oldest of 4. So my mother was widowed quite young. And I think, as I look back at it, of course at 7 you don't realize these things, but I was kind of thrust in the role of a surrogate parent and being responsible for my siblings. But it was, we're a very loving family. I was raised by my grandmother and my great-grandmother, all strong, productive women, excellent role models, in my opinion.
My mother had a philosophy that she was never poor. She was maybe broke once in a while, but never poor, because we had each other. And she always provided very well for us, the best that she could do, and I give my mother a lot of credit.
Hi, Mom. Ooh, don't you look pretty? Oh, Mother, you don't need a makeover. Can I make you over?
Georgette, I can remember her always looking at magazines to look at the fashions, to see how to do eye makeup, how to do hair. I think she has excellent taste. She always did everyone's hair when we were kids, everybody's makeup. Georgette was always driven, as far back as I can remember. Georgette was focused. Georgette knew what she wanted, but she knew that she had a direction. She knew it wasn't the direction of staying in this small hometown, that there was a bigger world out there, and that she wanted more, and she wanted to give more.
Biography will continue in a moment on A&E.
It has an extremely powerful engine, the most precise ergonomic design, and luxury appointments like hand-finished wood and fine leather. Introducing the Acura Vigor. Because even the man who flies the most sophisticated aircraft needs some excitement in his life.
At Valurite Pharmacies, you'll always find great American values, just like these. Pre-Sun 4-ounce lotion or 3.5-ounce spray are only $5.99 each. Get 50 GlucoFilm blood glucose test strips for $29.99. 100 test strips are just $54.99. And selected Dimetapp cold and coffee elixirs and tablets are only $3.69. Look in the yellow pages for participating Valurite pharmacies. There's one near you.
Another day, another frozen pizza. Whoa, what's this? Stouffer's French bread pizza? For moi? All right, let's rock! Ooh, very untraditional. Mmm, it's real cheese. Lots of great toppings. And this Stouffer's crust. Mmm, serious crunch and so thick.
Stouffer's French bread pizza is a cut above frozen.
How about another French revolution? Get it? Ha!
Great taste is just minutes away. Now Stouffer's pizzas are microwavable.
Visa and American Express both provide things like emergency card replacement and medical referral in their gold cards. But Visa thinks the best reason to have a gold card is being able to use it when you travel back to Cabo San Lucas. And the hotel where you fell in love doesn't take American Express. And that's what really matters. Visa Gold, accepted worldwide at 5 million more places than American Express. Visa Gold, it's everywhere you want to be.
We now return to the Masbaches.
After college, you worked with your father. What business was he?
Primarily in the real estate business, and a few very small oil interests. And I worked here in New York with my father and my brother in the office. And being the youngest, I was low man on the totem pole. And I may not be much of a leader, but I'm a terrible follower. I stayed with my father and brother in New York less than a year. And then I went to Texas. I was 21 years old when I went to Texas, and it was a great thrill. I had just gotten married, and we were off into a new adventure.
Masbacher arrived in Houston with a small sum of money from his father to help him get started.
Well, this young man came in my office and introduced himself as Robert Masbacher. And I said, well, I knew a number of years ago Emil Masbacher. He said, well, that's my father. And here's a letter he has written you. So I opened the letter and it said, this is my son, Robert. Look after him, Emil. So I immediately got interested in Bob, and he told me what he planned on doing was coming to Texas and getting the oil business.
Masbacher quickly earned the esteem and respect of the big Texas oil men like Michael T. Halbuti.
I was an independent before he came to Texas, of course, and he knew that I was and came to my office. And I think that I was one of the first that he ever visited to just say, Mr. Halberty, you're an independent. Just tell me some things that I can learn. I want to be a Texan. I want to come to this part of the world, and I want to wildcat for oil and gas. And he asked me. He said, "Well, you're successful." I said, "I'm successful so far." I said, "Of course, I can go broke." And since that conversation, I have been broke twice. And I've come back because, you know, this game, you can go broke very fast. And at the same time, you can come back very fast. And one time I hit 14 straight discoveries and turned right around and drilled 31 straight dry holes. So this is the way this business is made out of. And so I said, "Bob, if you're going to be a wildcatter, you've got to have the perseverance to stay with it." He wanted to know exactly what to do, how to do it. People that he should have on his staff, geologists, petroleum engineers, geophysicists, and he had learned what to do with them, and he went out and gathered the leases and drilled the wells and was successful. Oh, yes, we drilled several wells together, successful ones. One time we had over 60,000 independents drilling wells in the United States. Today we got maybe 1,000.
I graduated from Indiana University. I worked my way through college. I, on some occasions, did two jobs, held down two jobs at the same time. I did everything from being a switchboard operator to a waitress. So I ran the whole gamut. I modeled a little bit. I did everything. I approached the jobs with a positive attitude. That's why I didn't consider them hardships. I still felt that they were an opportunity for me. I think you learn responsibility. I think you learn the value of money. I also think that you learn that anything in life is basically what you make it.
Known Georgette Mosbacher, I'd probably say 15 years. Since she was very young, working in California. She was with Fabergé one time. She was like a press agent. She married Mr. Barry, who was head of Fabergé. They went together a long time. But when they got married, it was for about 5 minutes. It really didn't work. She then had Barry's money, of course. She could move around better. But it was not a happy experience. And I would say, really, in the social scene nationally in the United States, it's since she married Bob Mosbacher.
Well, I started buying royalties, which are part of the 1/8 usually that the landowner has, and buying leases. Then I moved from that, as I was starting in the oil business, into putting drilling deals together, buying leases, finding the drilling company, finding a geologist who'd work up where was a good place to drill. Then finding the people who put up the money to drill the wells. And then if you're very lucky, and if you do a good job, finding oil. First big discovery was gas discovery, natural gas. And it came about because a big oil company, one of the major oil companies, farmed out this very good prospect to us. And all I had to do was put all these leases together into one unit. And I did that, drilled a well, made a very good discovery. And later, when I thanked the people in the oil company for letting me have such a good project, they all laughed and said, "We knew you couldn't put it together because we've been trying for 4.5 years. And you surprised us. That's why you got the field. We thought you could never do it." Of course, discovering oil and gas has been the biggest events in making me prosperous. But also, we've tried to buy properties, real estate properties, out ahead of development. areas that were going to be developed later on. And that's been very good to me. That, and of course, always a lot of luck.
Mosbacher's company continues the search for oil and gas. Though his office at Mosbacher Energy Corporation is empty most of the time these days, his colleagues run the company while he fulfills his government duties, and it's business as usual while they wait for the boss to return.
Our major focus of operations really for the last 40 years has been in the Gulf Coast area. And onshore, we've been in Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, and Texas. More recently, we've gone into the offshore arena in the Gulf of Mexico. We've drilled a few wells in Texas, but not as many as we have in the past. Texas is historically where Bob has made the most money.
Georgette's married to a very wealthy man now. And if she wanted to, she would just do nothing. I mean, she could certainly afford to be the social lion and give the wonderful parties. But that isn't Georgette. Georgette has to be her person, too. And so she's head of La Prairie. Also, people think wrongly that Bob Mosbacher backed that for her and bought it. And of course, he was one of the investors. But as Bob will tell you, Georgette went out and knocked on doors and raised that money. $33 million, I think.
We're doing about $120 million worth of retail sales worldwide now. And I paid what I felt was a reasonable, fair market value for it. So I raised the money by going around the world and trying to sell private investors on my vision for the company. And I did the same with the bank. Fortunately, I was able to do that.
Where I'm supposed to be, what I'm supposed to be there this afternoon. So I fly. Being here is kind of refreshing, cool weather. He owns Clinic La Prairie.
Yeah. The moment we met her, a lot of people would have said the deal is dead. And a lot of people would have, you know, especially in her position, you know, married to a prominent businessman and not really needing the money or the work or anything like that. And I think it was really her determination to go after the company and convince the French. And funny enough, the French didn't really like her that much.
Why?
Because she was a woman. And since we still have these, I would say, these problems in our society to accept that women really can run companies, you always have a tendency to say, why is she just a society woman? Even so, she perhaps has a lot of merit as a businesswoman.
How would you describe her negotiating tactics?
She's very tough. I think she does a lot. She's tougher than Jarmin during negotiations. I mean, she's been putting out new products. She's been running around at a very hectic schedule. And she flies in the morning. She gives a business presentation over lunch. Then she has a meeting in the afternoon. In the evening, she meets agents, distributors, and just does one hell of a marketing job.
Very big products. I was just telling Max, I was bragging a little bit. We introduced the cosmetic color. Lipstick, nail polish, eyeshadow, taking La Prairie to a full cosmetic house.
I suffer with adult acne, and a friend of mine had just come back from the clinic, La Prairie in Montreux, Switzerland, and suggested I try some of the products, and I did. And needless to say, 10 years later, I'm afraid to stop using them because they have controlled my acne condition. I'd been in the cosmetic business for 7 years with Fabergé. When Fabergé was about to be sold, I decided I was ready to go off on my own. I had some ideas, but I wanted the very, very best, and I believed that beauty started with good skin, healthy skin. And that's when I decided I was going to go after La Prairie.
Critical to the success of La Prairie Cosmetics is the La Prairie Clinic, located on a lakeside in Montreux, Switzerland. Here, clients are treated with La Prairie products, the treatment consisting of vitamins A and E, collagen, sunscreen, elastin, hyaluronic acid, and a bit of stabilized sheep protein. People come from all over the world to be massaged, treated, and injected with the living protein cells. The clinic provides the basic ingredients for the La Prairie Cosmetics line.
Biography will continue in a moment on A.
Beating your competition to something is usually more hard work than it is inspiration. It's tenacity, it's willing to get up early and stay late and work weekends and not let up and stay with it. Never take no for an answer and make sure that you always stay pushing on your project.
In his office in the Transco Tower, John Lawler, another Texas oil man, talks about Mosbacher's business style.
There was always an inclination to resolve the issue while we're there, face to face. Let's get this matter resolved one way or the other. Let's come to an agreement that makes sense from both sides. And then at the end of the meeting, when you shake hands on the deal, you know with Bob that that's it. When he says he's going to do something, that's he does. Most people's perception of the business, I guess, has been gained through that crazy television program Dallas. Everyone thinks that that people that are in the oil and gas business are immediately wealthy. They forget that. Or they don't realize that more people go broke in this business every year than ever make it. But if you look at Mosbacher, he's been in the business for 35, 40 years. He's successful, and that's because he manages his risk conservatively. He knows how to identify a good prospect, and that's somebody that we like to participate in.
Proud of the place he has earned for himself in the oil business, Robert Mosbacher's current fortune is estimated at well over $200 million. Georgette Mosbacher's business has also grown substantially. The beautifully packaged and presented La Prairie collection is sold through the best specialty and department stores. Global distribution includes Canada, Switzerland, Japan, France, Germany, and Italy. Mosbacher travels the world to watch over the marketing of her products. On each trip, she meets with the salespeople in the shops and with her clients. In America, her approach is the same. Here at Saks in Chicago, she checks even the smallest details.
It's very important that Georgette gets into the stores and meets the customer and meets the girl who sells the product. It's very, very important to Georgette. So I make all the arrangements for that and then get her into the store. It's a lot of work, a lot of work. Georgette is very driven, a perfectionist, and knows exactly where she's going and what she wants to do. And sometimes the world isn't, it's a little slow for her because she wants to do everything now and wants it done now.
That's the way I feel. If it goes on my face, I'll try it. I need this.
The texture is different. The emulsion
is a little. And you just break them.
It's a very profitable company. I'm very happy to say that by the end of this year, after 3 years of ownership, we will have doubled our sales. So we are very excited and very proud of what we've been able to accomplish with La Prairie.
Ivana Trump, former wife of New York real estate tycoon Donald Trump and president of New York's famous Plaza Hotel, admires her friend.
Secrets of Georgette, hard work.
She works very, very hard. And she knows that nothing you get for free. You really have to do your homework. You have to work on something very hard. And she has a combination of the wonderful charm. She's terrific with people. She works very, very hard on everything what she does. She commits herself. There's incredible commitment and great discipline. I think the woman, if she's attractive, she has to have a brain, she has to have a knowledge, she has to do her homework.
I think women have a greater opportunity for choices today. They can really choose to be who and what they are. They no longer have to conform to the roles, the traditional role models of being just nurturers. But they can choose to go out into the world and be anything they really want to be. My husband has always been very supportive of my goals. Besides being very handsome and very kind and very dedicated, he's an extraordinary husband because he cares. I think he cares about people in general.
In Houston, Robert Mosbacher and his first wife, now deceased, and their four children lived in the chic residential neighborhood of River Oaks. The homes are expensive and custom built in moneyed Texas style. Jogging is the preferred sport here, and maybe a symbol of the competitive Texas spirit. President Bush, like Bob Mosbacher, left the East Coast to make his fortune in Texas oil.
After my wife died, there were quite a few friends who were very helpful and sympathetic, and no one more so than George and Barbara Bush, now President Bush. They called and would get me to go out and have dinner with them, and they were just so warm, and they haven't changed a bit. They're still those same warm, wonderful people who would call me to make sure I was all right over 20 years ago.
Washington lawyer and former counsel to President Carter, Lloyd Cutler, was Mosbacher's counselor when he came to Washington with Bush.
After World War II, George Bush, as a young man and a war veteran, went to Texas and went into the oil business himself in a much more modest way than the Mosbachers. But they knew one another then, and they had some business ventures together and became very good friends. So they are very much alike in that sense, although Mosbacher himself had never held a political office before his friend George Bush ran for the presidency. And then he assisted George Bush in raising money. And you know how much money we raise in our campaigns. Presidents raise, presidential candidates raise as much as $50 to $100 million today to get elected.
America needs George Bush and Barbara Bush as First Lady. George Bush, the next president of the United States.
Mosbacher raised over $60 million for the Bush campaign. His response rate was almost 50%.
I found that the way to raise money is the same way you do everything else, is you stick with it. And at this time, they changed the law so that no one could give more than $1,000. So the secret was going out and getting people who were willing to help raise that money. And so I found all my friends and made some new friends and brought more people in to the effort, and I made everyone feel a part of it, or I tried to, and we all shared the credit as it came.
Thank you, and God bless you.
And today I want to nominate the remainder of that top team. There are other very important posts to fill, but this is the remainder of the very top team. First, I intend to submit the name of Robert Mosbacher, a friend of longstanding, a very successful leader in the business community, as my nominee for Secretary of Commerce.
Well, I was very flattered and very honored when he asked me to be Secretary of Commerce. I was thrilled but worried. I appreciated his confidence in me, and I care so much for President Bush, having known him for over 30 years, and I respect his judgment and his integrity so much, that I wanted to be a part of his team. However, I'm by nature a private sector, sort of private person, so I was concerned how it would work out, and we'll have to wait until it's over to know how it did, won't we?
When Mr. Mosbacher was appointed, he asked me to be his lawyer and to assist him in filing his financial disclosure reports about all of his investments and advising him on what he had to dispose of, to sell, in order to avoid what we call conflicts of interest. We do not allow a public official to own securities or a business if the public official must make decisions affecting that business. Georgette, who is, as everyone knows today, a beautiful, smashing woman, loved to drive around New York and Texas in her Maserati. And one piece of advice I had to give them was that she could not come to Washington with her Maserati. In addition to that, he had a private jet. And the Mosbachers would go everywhere, and they would fly to the Riviera, they would fly wherever they wanted to go in their jet. And I had to advise them that they could no longer fly in the corporate jet. In fact, the jet has already been sold.
As Secretary of Commerce, that I am most responsible for in our economy is making sure that our exports are built and that we have fair trade around the world. We want to see free trade around this entire world, but it must be a two-way street. We should and do keep our market, the biggest market in the world, open to others, and we expect them to do that for us. I think our outlook long-term for our economy is very good.
There he is. How are you? How are you? I'm glad to see you.
Hey, John.
How have you been?
Stay with me. Mr. Shin, as member of National Assembly.
As part of his job, Mosbacher deals with foreign commerce representatives from the world over. His goal, to raise American economic competitiveness with the Europeans and especially with the Japanese, and to forge new commercial relationships with the recently liberated countries of Eastern Europe.
Reagan Marcus, Secretary.
Nice to see you again, Ellen Magazine.
Yeah.
That we are awarding these.
Could you mention a few of the U.S. companies who earned the award?
Yes. Originally, one of the companies, the first year was Motorola.
Mosbacher's relations with Soviet President Mikhail Gorbachev have lent a hand in promoting new commercial relationships. With Secretary of State James Baker and a group of American businessmen, he was recently in Moscow promoting trade.
When I was in Moscow, I had an interesting meeting with President Gorbachev. He is very quick. He is very animated and feisty in a positive way. And I find that whether I was talking to Mr. Gorbachev or the other officials there, they all agreed on wanting to base their economy on the Western market-oriented economies. And they like dealing with America, and they like dealing with Westerners.
Industrially, Japan is the United States' fiercest competitor. Rockefeller Center in New York was once symbolic of American capitalism. In 1989, it was purchased by Mitsubishi of Japan.
I'm dealing with the Japanese very often. I think they are moving towards opening up their market, but it's still a long ways to go, and it's something we still have to work on very hard together. I'm encouraged, and we are working more closely with them. And I think sailing, more than almost any other sport, teaches you competitive instincts that are more than just the physical competitive instincts. They're those, but they're also the mental leapfrogging ahead that you must do in sailing. You must look down the line and anticipate what's going to happen next. And I think it helped very much in that area. And when I was very young, I won the National Midget Championship, and then I won the National Atlantic Class Championship until I won the World's Championships in both the Dragon Class, Olympic class at the time, and then later in the Soling Class, another Olympic class.
On the Gulf of Mexico, Bob's friend and fellow crew member Tommy Dickey remembers good old days.
The first time I remember the man, we were in the midst of a sailboat race out here, and I was crewing for an older fella. Front came through, a norther, just like the one that's getting ready to hit us now. Came through, and in the race, it started blowing 30 miles an hour or so. We actually sank the boat out here. It got very cold, and I was in the water. I swam underneath the deck to release the halyards to let the sails down. Another one of the competitors came by and hollered, Charlie, are you all right? And it was Bob Moss back. So he came back and threw me a line. I kind of felt like he saved my life. So I got to sail with him then, and he was extremely understanding, knew that I didn't know anything about sailing, and we sailed a sailboat race, had a great time. He's a very fair person, very demanding, but he comes out there to win. We have never gone into a sailboat series that he didn't expect to win. He says he's as good as anybody else, and if we try real hard, we'll win, and usually he does win.
Well, I feel great when I win. I love it. I love winning, and I'm afraid I love winning almost as much as I hate losing.
Robert Mosbacher's extraordinary will to win has influenced his children as well. Robert Mosbacher Jr. aspires to a political career. Here in Houston, Mosbacher Sr. has come to help his son with his campaign.
You gave us a good talk in Dallas.
Look at how skinny you are. How are you?
What?
The family is very close-knit. His four children, three sons and a daughter, are from his previous marriage. And Mosbacher enjoys playing grandfather. Washington's Palm Restaurant is frequented by many political power brokers. Its owner, Wally Ganzi.
Georgette has really gone out of her way, I think, not to upstage anyone, to keep a low profile here in Washington. She's very sought after by the press all the time. She is also a very warm person. She is anything but snobby. Sometimes, as a matter of fact, Georgette is even shy. Difficult things when he became Secretary of Commerce, that the hours are so demanding and the job is so demanding that their life, they have been greatly separated. This is a sacrifice for both of them because he lives here in Washington, his office is here in Washington, and he was commuting almost every day. He would finish and catch the last shuttle, the 9:30 shuttle to New York, so he could be with his wife, and catch the first shuttle back at 6:30. And he did this for about 3 months until I thought he was going to fall down. He was so tired. So it's, that says something about their relationship, that you want to be together to do that.
Well, I'm on an airplane 2-3 times a week easily, oftentimes more. And that's mostly business related, so it's not with my husband. Basically, we have one sacrosanct rule, and that is that we really save our weekends for each other. We are so looking forward to seeing one another that we focus on each other. We really have quality time together. I think the prerequisite to marital harmony is being married to someone that is very secure and doesn't feel any competition with you. I don't think there's anything you can do physically, mentally, emotionally, if your mate feels competitive.
For Robert and Georgette Mosbacher, home is in New York, in the apartment they have recently purchased on Fifth Avenue, across from the Metropolitan Museum. It's here that they meet each Friday after a long week devoted to their separate careers, a point that the independent-minded Georgette likes to emphasize.
I believe I have my own identity, but that takes nothing away from his identity or our identity as a couple. But we are individuals, and I always say that I am not half of a whole. I'm a whole of a whole, and he's a whole of a whole. But that doesn't mean that we aren't supportive and together in supporting one another.
True.
The fact of having a career wife, how do you feel about it?
I'm very proud of her. I have no problem with that. People ask me that all the time. And I think they expect me to say, well, I wish she were home. So when I get there, she'd be there. But there are times I feel that way. But most of the time, I'm just delighted that she has something that she's doing that keeps her fascinated and working hard. I can't always make my own decisions as to where I want to be and where we can meet, but we work it out together to coordinate our schedules as best we can.
I've been fortunate to fulfill some of my dreams, but I can't imagine life without another dream to work towards and to aspire to. I live an aspirational life. I encourage aspirational ideals. And I think it's what gives us the spice and the sense of feeling productive. I think you need dreams to reach for, to really get to live a productive life. So yes, oh yes, I have other dreams.
My goals for the next 10 years are first to get through this government service, being some help to our president, to our country. And then to go back to the private sector and go back to the challenges, which are so exciting, of both making money and building companies and creating jobs and also being an opportunity to help others.
Tonight, the Mosbachers attend a March of Dimes gala held in New York's Plaza Hotel. He has flown in from Washington, she from Chicago. Their social life is exciting and demanding. even if they arrive late and stay just a few minutes. To some, Robert and Georgette Mosbacher represent a symbol of what is possible in America.
General Motors Playwrights Theater. Tragedy turns to romance for mismatched college students on the American television premiere. It's called the